Good afternoon to everyone, and thank you so much for being here today. My name is Ron Aiken. I'm the Media Relations Director for DHEC today. We're here to talk about our agency's new prescription monitoring program, visual data representation dashboards that provide insight of controlled substance prescriptions that are dispensed throughout the state of South Carolina. These dashboards will show dispensation information by time, place, and drug category for three different categories of substances: opioids, benzodiazepines, and stimulants. They'll also feature key demographic data at the state and county levels. Today, we'll be hearing from DHEC Director Dr. Edward Simmer, from DAODAS Director of Alcohol and Other Drug Abuse Services Director Sarah Goldsby, and Program Staff Chelsea Townsend, Director of the Prescription Monitoring Program, and Samantha Donnelly, the Program Epidemiologist. Following the staff presentation of the dashboards, we'll open the floor to media questions, and we do have a hard stop today at 1:30 p.m. So we'll start by welcoming Dr. Simmer, DHEC Director. Thank you so much for being with us, and I'll turn the floor over to you.
All right. Thank you, Ron. Good afternoon, everyone. Appreciate everyone attending. And, you know, I'm really excited about this new data source, the prescription monitoring program dashboard that we are announcing and have made available to the public today. I think this is going to be a very important source of information for people who are trying to address the drug crisis in our state. As you probably know, the number of people who are misusing drugs has significantly increased, as has the number of overdoses and sadly, the number of deaths due to drug use. And as we approach this is, we know that there's not one group, one agency that can solve this problem on their own. We need to work together with groups all across the state to impact this problem and help improve the health of the people of South Carolina. And I think this dashboard is going to be a big piece of doing that. You know, this dashboard is derived from the data on prescriptions for controlled substances that are collected all across the state. Let me emphasize that no individual patient data is here. Patient privacy is being very carefully maintained. But this will allow both on a statewide basis, but also by each county, people to access data on the number of prescriptions, the number of drugs that are entering their community through prescription sources, and hopefully give them an additional tool to help them combat this problem. So we're very excited about this. I especially would like to thank Chelsea Townsend, the director of the program, and Samantha Donnelly, who really are the brain. This was their brainchild. They brought this to fruition, and I am very thankful for the great work that they have done. You know, I think when you look at the work that we're doing at DHEC in the area of drug abuse, you know, we are very focused on drug control. We work closely with providers across the state, both by licensing and providing controlled substance registration to providers in the state, tracking that data, making it publicly available like we're doing here, and also doing a lot of education work. You may also know that through our health departments, we provide free overdose prevention kits that include both naloxone that can reverse the impact of an opioid overdose, and fentanyl strips so that people can test substances they may be taking to ensure that fentanyl, which is often fatal even in very small amounts, is not contained in the substance and they don't know it. So we're doing a number of things to try to reduce the impact of drugs in our state. But again, this is absolutely a team effort. We are hopeful this data will bring many more people into the work that is being done. And on that note, I would like to turn the floor over to our director of DAODAS, the state agency that is primarily responsible for ensuring that drug treatment is provided in our state in addressing the drug crisis. We feel very fortunate to collaborate very closely with them as they lead the efforts statewide to improve health in this area. So with that, let me turn things over to Director Goldsby. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Dr. Simmer. Really appreciate everyone being on today. We know that a lot of work has been going on over the years to address the drug crisis. And it's well known that the opioid crisis was really fueled by the overprescribing of narcotics to address pain in the 1990s and in the early 2000s. And while prescribing is most often done with very well-meaning intentions, South Carolina and other states have acted over the last decade or longer to really help correct and address the overprescribing and the misuse of prescription drugs. the greatest impact of the work that's been done to address addiction to prescribed medications has really been related to the use of the prescription monitoring program. And our General Assembly has passed several bills. In addition to that, just a lot of work has really been done over the years in relation to policy and in practice to ensure that our prescribers and pharmacists and others like coroners are maximizing the potential of the prescription monitoring program. It's an informational tool that really leads to better care of individuals and better oversight of the prescription medications being dispensed. Also, as medical professionals can see how their prescribing relates to the average of the prescribers around them, they tend to make adjustments in their own practice patterns. And so now the high-level data from our prescription monitoring program is available to everyone through these dashboards. There's more real-time information and transparency about the opioids, stimulants, and sedatives that are being dispensed across the state. And this data is going to help everyone working to address the drug crisis more easily see the patterns and trends related to medications that have the potential for misuse and dependency. So what's available on this dashboard and in this data, it's really going to help us to explore more deeply any variations that are seen across counties and demographics. The data here is actionable data, and we know that the state and now local communities can really use this information as we keep working to prevent the misuse of medications. It's really incredible to see how far South Carolina has come in this work, and that's thanks to DHEC and the incredible team at the Bureau of Drug Control who've been central to upholding really the highest quality of care with medications to protect South Carolina. Having this data publicly available is something to be proud of. And it's certainly, as Dr. Simmer said, one more tool that will be used to help keep moving ahead as we collectively address the crisis with addiction. These dashboards will be available in multiple places, but for the public and the layperson who visits justplainkillers.com, they'll be able to see this data along with find information about accessing treatment and recovery services, and even some basic information about how to think through and have different conversations about alternatives to prescriptions with their healthcare professionals. So a lot of work being done. We feel especially proud to see DHEC getting this information out today, and really want to say thank you to our partners and the unified effort we have across the state. And so now I will turn it over to the one and only Chelsea and Samantha with our Bureau of Drug Control. Thanks.
Thank you, Sarah. Good afternoon, everyone. I wanted to thank you all for joining us today. The program went live in 2008 with the purpose of improving the state's ability to identify and stop diversion of prescription medications without preventing the appropriate medical use of them. Throughout the last few years, the Prescription Monitoring Program, DHEC, and the Bureau of Drug Control, we've really focused on presenting the data in a way that would be educational and useful to the public and to our stakeholders, including publishing annual reports. However, we wanted to find a way to present this data in a more real-time way, which is why we created this dashboard. A couple of things to note about the dashboard. This is an interactive dashboard. We encourage you to hover over the visualizations. It'll present trend lines, a little bit of extra data on each visualization. It will show data for a rolling two-year period, and we will update this quarterly. It's also important to note that any categories with less than 11 individuals and counties with less than 3 dispensers were included from the dashboard. This was to protect patient confidentiality. And then lastly, we have embedded a survey within each dashboard. We encourage people to take the survey and provide feedback. We want to give the most valuable data to the public and to stakeholders. So if there's something within this dashboard that you're like, wow, we would really love to see this, or just this would really help us, we really encourage you guys to take the survey and provide feedback to us. So I'm now going to turn it over to Samantha Donnelly, who's our program's epidemiologist, and she's going to present an overview of the data contained within the dashboard.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen so that we can all look at the dashboard together. Okay, so as you can see, this is published on our DHEC's webpage. I believe it's scdhec.gov/PMP. And you can go and look at the three different dashboards we're showing. Today, I'm just going to show our opioid trends dashboard. But again, I encourage you all to go look at the benzodiazepine trends and the stimulant trends for our state. So when you open up the dashboard, you'll see overall just the South Carolina trends that are going on. Your first visualization will be the total number of patients that are dispensed opioids in South Carolina. And as Chelsea mentioned, you can hover over these visuals and it'll give you more information about the visual itself. So as we can see today, there's been a 1% decline in the number of patients dispensed opioids. This next visual breaks the information out by males and females. So you can see that females are dispensed more opioids compared to males. We also break this out by average age. You can hover over these and see what percentage of that age group makes up the total. You can see our 65 and older age group is our largest age group that is dispensed opioids. We also felt for the opioids that it was important to break it out by in three different categories. This one to the left here looks at opioids primarily prescribed for cough and GI issues. The one in the middle looks at opioids primarily prescribed for pain. And then the last one on the right looks at opioids primarily prescribed to combat substance use disorder. So for each of these, you can see how many opioids have been dispensed in South Carolina, as well as the, the top prescriptions that are dispensed for each of those categories. We also show at the bottom here the rate of opioid prescriptions adjusted by 1,000 people per pharmacy county. And then this is broken up into those three opioid categories. You can mouse over and see what your county ranks out of all the counties that we're looking at for those opioids. And as Chelsea mentioned, if there was three dispensers or less, they were excluded from this analysis. So that's why you see that number 39 out of 43 counties, three of the counties were excluded from this analysis. Then over to the left, we have all your different options. Right now we're looking at state trends. You can also flip over to county trends and then look at our contact information. We also have different filters that you can play with where you can look at 2022, 2023, or 2024 data. I'm gonna flip over to county trends right now. So this right here, we have on the left where you can select whatever county you're interested in looking at. The dashboard currently displays Abbeville County. So we have here what compared to the number of opioids that were dispensed this time last year, how is Abbeville doing? So we can see there's been a 6% decrease. We also compare the county trend to South Carolina as a whole. We show the top five opioids that were dispensed in that county. And then we also break it out by the percentage of males and females and the different age categories of the number of opioids that were dispensed. And again, there's all these filters that you can play around with. You can select different age groups. And depending, again, that 18 to younger group had less than 11 people, so that's why it wasn't displayed. But if you select an age category that does have more than 11 people, you'll get to see the trend over time. And then over here, we have where you can select your contact information. That'll give you the email where you can reach out to us directly. Or again, we welcome the feedback from the public. Again, this is the public's dashboard. We want to provide the most pertinent information that everyone is interested in. That is it for our dashboard.
Thank you so much, Samantha. Thank you, Chelsea. Before we open it up for live questions, just want to remind everyone the purpose of this briefing is to talk about our PMP dashboards. If you have any other questions for us, go through our normal media relations channel at media@dhec.sc.gov. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and I'll recognize you in the order in which it was raised. And then out of fairness, I'll try to get to everyone interested in asking questions first before I come back for any follow-ups. And I'll also add that a recording of today's briefing will be available this afternoon on our YouTube page as soon as we can get it uploaded. Any questions for our panelists? All you need to do is raise your virtual hand. I don't see any at the moment. Okay, yeah, there we go. Go ahead, Skylar.
Yeah, Director Simmer mentioned the potential for people and, you know, the public using this information. I was curious as to, you know, how a layperson might be able to use this.
Sure. I think there's several ways that we hope they might be able to use this. You know, for example, lay people certainly could include local officials because you can get data by county. We think this information will help local officials make decisions about how to use their limited funds to best impact in their communities. But I think a member of the public can also use this data to have a better understanding of what is the severity of the problem in my community, in my area, and then, you know, help shape, you know, either by talking to their local officials or the legislators and others, public policy, but also perhaps to work with local organizations that do a lot of the great work in this area, whether that's to volunteer with them or to, you know, encourage them to focus on certain things. So I think public knowledge of the severity of the problem and the types of drugs that we're seeing and what the trends are can go a long way to help shape the responses that our communities make to this terrible crisis.
Thank you for that question, Skylar. Any other questions? Any follow-up, Skylar?
That answered it. Thank you.
All right, thank you. All right, Tom, go ahead, sir.
Am I unmuted? I'm sorry.
You are. Go ahead.
Okay, great. So I don't know if this infringes on the only talk about this dashboard rule, but there are other dashboards and resources where you can look at overdoses or including non-fatal overdoses. And is there any thought to somehow combining those two or linking them? I'll put that to whoever wants to answer it.
Thank you, Tom. Anybody want to tackle that one?
Yeah. At this point, I know that kind of the data sets are different. We do collect naloxone data administrations, which are displayed for prescribers. And I'm hopeful that eventually we'll be able to combine these data sets. That's definitely something to look into us doing in the future. So that's a really great idea because I think the two data sets go hand in hand.
Thank you. And also, Tom, I would add, we recently put a release out about our biosurveillance dashboard, which is on our website, which contains information where people who in the hospital side have overdoses that come into the hospitals, they can then send us the information, the blood work and others from those admissions, where we can then determine what drugs were in a particular person who was admitted for an overdose. And so because of these data sets coming from a lot of different places and sort of showing up in different dashboards, it does mean that we can get a good look at this information. It's kind of hard to put it all. That certainly would be ideal all in one place, but I think having them at least in one website, one location like the DHEC website or the Just Plain Killers, as Director Goldsby mentioned, at least gives us the opportunity as a community to be able to look at this information and as Dr. Simmer said, make valuable sort of analyses from them and understand the context and the scope of the problem. Clint, you had a question.
Yes, I just wanted to know, which drugs are we seeing the most overdoses of? How are these drugs working to cause overdoses? And are there any factors that are seeing this increased trend?
I can speak a little bit to that. Based on what we've been seeing, a lot of the overdoses now are related to fentanyl, as you all know, in the illicit supply. I think some of the data work to be done is, and some of what DHEC is really excellent at, is identifying, you know, the co-presence of multiple substances, some being illicit and some being prescribed, you know, and that's unique to each individual. But when we look at broad data sets, we can see trends. So we know that stimulants right now, illicit stimulants such as methamphetamine and cocaine, which are adulterated with illicit fentanyl, in that illicit supply really are driving the overdoses that we're seeing currently. That said, and I forgot really the core of the question, I think it is important, going back to an earlier question, to really keep looking at trends over time and how things are changing. Because some of the data that we see in these dashboards shows us what we've been observing over the last few years, which is that stimulants are really on the rise for being prescribed to our citizens at higher rates in the most recent years than we had seen, let's say, ahead of 2020. And so it really does make you sort of ask more questions about why we're seeing the rise of stimulant prescriptions, benzodiazepine prescriptions, in a way that is different than we saw maybe 5 or 10 years ago. So I think, you know, all of this data collectively helps us really ask more questions and zero in on, you know, the problems that we're seeing, but even better than that, potential solutions. And a lot of that can be related back to discussions with our healthcare providers, those healthcare providers being informed, and citizens feeling informed as they approach those conversations with their healthcare providers.
Thank you for that, Director Goldsby, very much. Do you have any other questions from our media partners? Emma, go ahead, please.
Thank you. I wanted to ask, I know that people can go on there and share their feedback through that survey at the end, but I was wondering if in the county by county breakdown, are there any links or pages that may post local resources for addiction or rehabilitation?
I would say right now, no, but that's a great idea. And I think we could do that. So thank you for that. And we'll take that back and we'll see what we can do. I think that's a great idea.
And Director Goldsby, did you want to add something to that?
No, just to say it is a great idea. And we could offer more information about where to get help through other websites. But I think to Emma's point, linking that would be very helpful for the public.
Thank you. Thank you for that question, Emma. I thought I saw another hand pop up. Anyone? Yes, go ahead, Cassidy.
Sorry, I had to unmute myself for a moment there. Understanding that this is newly released, have there been any healthcare providers that have helped you all come up with any of these categories specifically, you know, what they're looking for and what will help them in looking into this data?
That's a good question. As far as healthcare providers go, they see the data kind of differently on a patient level report, and they kind of make clinical decisions based on that. However, we did look, we have research requests that come from stakeholders across the state. Those could be doctors at universities doing research projects. Those could be county level officials that are doing various research projects. And when we created this dashboard, we pulled together all of those data requests to say what were the most requested data elements. And we also participate on overdose fatality review teams, the overdose emergency response team for the state. There are various groups that we also participate in. So we collectively gathered this feedback, and that those are the data variables that we put into the dashboard and presented to you guys.
Thank you for that question. Thank you, Chelsea. Do we have any further questions for our media guests? I'm going to say that seeing none, as mentioned earlier, the link to that dashboard, you'll receive a release about this shortly. There's also a link in the chat, in addition to a link to the biosurveillance dashboard. I encourage all of you to take a look at those dashboards and play around with them. As a former journalist who still identifies as one, I see lots of story opportunities in there by age, by drug type, by region, especially. The more we can educate the public about the nature and scope of the problem, the better able we are to make good, informed decisions. And we very much appreciate y'all's help in getting this message out in terms of education. I want to thank Dr. Simmer today for being available, Director Goldsby for her time and partnership, and also to Chelsea and Samantha for their time in making these dashboards available, and to all of you, our media partners, who help us do so much to educate the public about the issues that are critical importance to South Carolinians' health and well-being. Again, as I mentioned, a copy of this briefing will be available later on today on our YouTube page, and I appreciate your time. If you have any further questions or follow-ups after this, just reach out to us via the media inbox, media@dhec.sc.gov. And with that, take care, everyone, and thank you so much for your time today.